I'm Anita Marcos, and I wish you didn't ask me the year I was born. I was born in 1944.
Great. And if you could just tell me, what are some of the, or one principle that you live your life by?
The one principle, I think probably have to be equality. You know, equality and justice. Mm-hmm. I think at the core of my beingness, I'm a firm believer in just civil rights. I think once you lose your civil rights, you know, that's what it's all about.
And I know you were born in Ecuador, but doing work in Texas as a feminist, do you think that was a unique experience compared to feminists in other areas of the country?
Well, I was introduced, because I think some of us are feminists or all our lives, but I did a lot of work in the Northeast, in the New York, New Jersey area. I used to live in New Jersey. And the big difference I found when I moved to Texas was that the media was not as accessible as it was in the Northeast. In the Northeast, the media was there all the time. ABC, CBS, they were all there all the time. And in here, the media just wasn't that accessible. That was one of the biggest difference I found. And then the other difference I found was that feminists, if you so want, and I'm going to, that was my personal experience, so I want to make sure I say that. You know, it's not want to generalize, it's what I have found. It was almost like they were a little more polite, if you so want, a little more Texas-like, more Southern-like, than in the Northeast, that maybe were a little more direct. And that was, for me, an adjustment.
What would you say are some of the most difficult battles, or the most difficult battle you've had as part of the feminist movement? And would you consider that battle a success?
If I was to look at the ones that brought the most passion and perhaps even insults to us, was reproductive rights. Mm-hmm. It was definitely reproductive rights for marches we had. I did some, not just me, but many of us did, we did vigils on the clinics because we were so worried they were gonna be bombed, and we were called baby killers. And I'm a mother of six, so I hardly a baby killer, and I have lots of grandkids. But that's what we were called, and nobody wanted to hear the word choice, that what we were saying was choice. And that was a very, difficult battle because of that. And then the other one was ERA. ERA, which to me always seemed a very simple, basic right. It was a very simple amendment, didn't have anything else. It was just very simply worded. It became so confused, and I found myself sometimes not even having answers, because when people look at you and said, the reason why we don't want this, and we're talking about women, is because we don't want to share a bathroom with men. You know, I remember I used to answer, that's okay, I'll share my bathroom with a man if you give me my rights. You know, but, you know, the bottom line was that was very difficult, because I don't know if the words was lies or just the misunderstandings about it, or the campaign. There was a tremendous campaign that was launched against ERA. It was very difficult. You couldn't go on an interview, you couldn't do anything without having people put you down. So that was a very difficult thing that I feel had no reason. You know, I never understood that.
So through those battles, I mean, when you had hard times like that, was there a certain group or a certain person that you would, you know, rely on when you were in that face of adversity like that?
What do you mean, person?
Like, you mean, was there someone you went to for support when you were?
I think the most wonderful thing about the feminist movement is that we supported each other so much. We nurture one another so much. It's like nothing I have ever experience before or after. The groups were so nurturing, is a good word. to each other. So I think that had a lot to do with it. I mean, we just supported each other. We just heard each other. We encouraged each other. So I think the group itself.
And I know you've been involved with NOW in many ways. And I was just wondering if you could tell a specific story and an example that maybe changed the way you thought about the feminist movement or where you thought it needed to go, or your future work as you continue.
Well, I really believe that in the very early days of NOW, one of the things that was at the core of the organization was what we used to call CR, which is consciousness raising. And what we did is we got together and we formed groups, and we would talk about whatever was bothering us. We talk about ourselves, our families, our work. And it really truly was consciousness raising, because you got to see yourself, not just what was inside of you, but you got to see yourself in your sisters. And so what I really believe today is that we need to somehow go back to that, to form groups at whatever level, whether it's in schools, whether it's in neighborhoods, where women come together to talk about their issues. And their issues could be sometimes just, what do I do to find daycare? You know, where do I go? But I think naturally we women know how to network. And so, in a sense, it's a form of education. I really believe that we need to know. And the other thing for me is that it has been 30 years that we've been at this or more, and we're still not present in the history books. Mm-hmm. Way back then, I thought, you know, all this, and yet we're still not there. We still, our story, what I call her story, is still not told. So you want, those are the two areas that I would really like to see change.
I know you're a mother, and what kind of ideals do you want to instill in your children, and what would you encourage them to do in order to change their generations and the issues that they're facing?
What I have done with my children, all six of them, I have four daughters and two sons, is to teach them that every single human being has value. It doesn't matter what color they are, it doesn't matter what sex they are, doesn't matter what sexual preference they have, every single human being has value. And to look at that person in the eyes and to remember their value. And I always told them when they got married, they needed to look at their partner as equals. Because that's, I believe, the only way you can really have a good relationship is that you have to. Now, remembering the equality is not sameness. I think if people get a little confused and they think equality, sameness. We're not talking about sameness. We all can have our differences and we can honor those differences, but we have to value each other within those differences. And so that's one of the things I try always to teach my children, to honor people for who they were, no matter what they were, and what stage in life they were, whether they were rich or poor. It's irrelevant. It really is the value of the human being. And so I think they have done that. I think they have done a great job, and I think they have chosen partners in their life that believe the same things that they do, and now they're raising children. They are the same way. They have that value system.